Chairman of the Council of Governors, Honorable Wycliffe Ambetsa Oparanya, the Governor of the County of Kirinyaga, Madam Anne Waiguru, the Speaker, Governors, the Senators, MCS, ladies and gentlemen, Amjambo. Amjambo tena. I feel very honored to have opportunity to come and talk to you this morning. Initially, I had been invited, but the date clashed with my other program as the AU High Representative on Infrastructure Development. That's why I told the Governor Oparanya that I may not be able to make it. But somehow I was able to wriggle out of that to enable me to come and be with you here today. I always look forward to coming to this event. I do so because I continue to believe that devolution is the best thing that Kenyans ever gave themselves since independence. And I come here faithfully because I recognize and respect the governors and the work they do as the people on the ground. Last year, when we were in Kakamega, there was an adverse report about Kirinyaga that the deputy governor had been attacked somewhere. Of course, it was like a blackmail. And I think because of that, Anne Waiguru actually decided to campaign that Kirinyaga be the next host. So they can benefit from what Kakamega did benefit from. The last time, the Governor Oparanya was very grateful that the delegates were working very hard, but also sparing him the electricity bills at night because they're working without lights. As these people on the ground, governors have a good idea what works and what does not, what should remain and what should be improved and what should be scrapped or discarded outright. And that is also why I continue to call for a close and cordial working relationship that is between the county government and the national government. When counties are functional, the entire country is functional. So ladies and gentlemen, in the success story we are witnessing with devolution lies another story that we rarely tell. It is the story of change. Change is always scary. A human being is a very conservative animal. It is always used to the beaten path. This is the road from home to the water place. So long as you remain on that road, there will be no problem. But when you deviate, then there will be resistance. It implies a shift in thinking and reorganization of institutions, communities, and even government. That is why change is resisted through numerous excuses. But change is good. If you do not change, the change will change you. The story of devolution tells us never to fear change. The story of certain parts of the country getting tarmac roads, piped water, and streetlights for the first time since independence proves that devolution has brought life where both the colonial government and independent Kenya failed. Change is the only constant thing in life. Successful nations are those that refuse to settle for less and constantly review and probe their systems and structures with a view to making them more perfect and responsive to the emerging challenges and changing circumstances. Devolution has done what conventional thinking and the fear of change failed to do for over 50 years. Nobody should take that for granted. Today, I wish to share some quick thoughts on our journey of change going forward, particularly with regard to devolution. I will be appealing to you to be brave and bold and never fear to push for change just because you will make enemies. What the successes of two levels of government means is that devolution is here to stay with us. It means that even as we talk of the need for constitutional reforms to perfect and strengthen our governance, devolved units will remain part of the reform structure we intend to create. Our task should be to ask ourselves how. Because this devolution conference is taking place against the background of intense debate about constitutional reforms, one of the issues we must address ourselves to here is what should be the most appropriate structure and content of sustainable devolved government in Kenya now and into the future. One of the facts we are dealing with, but hardly acknowledging, is that a number of our counties as they are today are too tiny to compete and to marshal internal and external resources for their development. They are small in population, based for agricultural production, manufacturing, innovation, and infrastructural development. I believe our counties would do better were they to be grouped into bigger entities. The creation of regional blocks is a logical response to dealing with this problem of economies of scale in enhancing the potential for development of counties. This forum, the Council of Governors, should robustly consider and debate the need for using the envisaged constitutional reforms to formalize regionalism in law. The need is clearly there. That is why we are witnessing the emergence of regional economic blocks such as Jumia ya County Zapwani, Lake Region Economic Block, Mount Kenya and Abadeas Counties Economic Block, North Rift Economic Block, Southeastern Kenya Economic Block, and Frontier Counties Development Council, among others. Formalization of regionalism would not necessarily mean dismantling the counties as they are today. For comparative purposes, we have a perfect example in the US and other countries in Africa where they have county, federal, and state governments. Nobody should stifle this debate for fear of change or merely political expediency. In South Africa, they have the county, the provincial, and the national. In Nigeria, they have the county, the state, and the national. We also acknowledge that this gathering has happened without fail for the last 6 years. I congratulate you for keeping it going. However, to make it more effective and avoid being seen as a mere talking shop, I want to recommend that devolved units adopt some kind of peer review mechanism and a system of performance evaluation and reporting. The national government has enthusiastically embraced peer review mechanism and has been recognized in Africa for that. Last month, we were in Addis Ababa And four countries were being reviewed: Angola, Equatorial Guinea, I think it was also Mali, and Djibouti. And it was a very interesting thing to listen to, and the kind of debate that arose as a result of that. The national government, it is in the turn of our counties, it is the turn of our counties to come up with a similar framework for independent assessment. I'm talking of a structured journey for peer learning, capacity building, ensuring that we emulate success stories and correcting one another to improve the lives of our people. I am not talking of a program for punishing people, the one for identifying strong and positive programs and processes, but sharing them and rectifying our individual weaknesses. It should be open and participatory and should include all stakeholders, including civil society organizations, women, youth, trade unions, and the private sector. I believe that NEPAD officers in Nairobi would only be too happy to work with you on this journey. You remember, during the Grand Coalition Government, we introduced a system of performance contracting. And in that process, we were able to review the performance of ministries and grade them, the county councils, the universities, the parastatals, and so on. And it actually helped to improve performance in service delivery in all those institutions. Then there's the question of intragovernmental and intergovernmental relationship as envisaged in the Constitution. We need clearer modalities for embracing, promoting, and institutionalizing the principles of cooperation, collaboration, consultation, coordination, consensus, and concurrence between these two governments. In particular, we need a clearer framework for money following functions in a more structured and predictable manner. We need a clearer framework for involvement of county governments in the realization of the Big Four agenda of housing, agriculture, manufacturing, and healthcare. There are far too many gray areas at the moment. Here, we need to call a spade a spade, that most of these big four agenda programs are devolved functions. And therefore, the county government should take the lead in implementation of these, and that resources should be devolved to the county government to do them. There is no need for enhancing resources at the national level for health when health is a devolved function. There's no need for the national government to procure medical equipment for the county government. The county government among themselves should create a mechanism for bulk purchases of equipment and supplies in the health sector. The same will go with housing. The same should also go with agriculture, generally. These are functions which have been devolved. The Minister of Agriculture should not be busy procuring fertilizers for farmers. The county government should be doing so. So the resources need to be devolved. Roads don't need to be properly classified. And when I was Minister for Roads and Public Works and Housing, we did a national road reclassification throughout. The one which was done after that, the one which was meant to remove some function from the counties. I think we should go back to the reclassification of roads which was done in 2003, 2004, to be clear as which roads should go to the counties and which roads should be the responsibility of the national government. In my view, the national government should deal with international highways and national trunk roads, period. The rest should be the responsibilities of counties. Further, we need a clearer framework for the partnership in addressing our troubled fiscal situation, with particular focus on our revenue collection in the counties. Improved revenue collection in our counties is important, not only for counties, but for the national economy as well. In the spirit of intergovernmental relations, the national government needs to provide counties with practical and effective experiences for boosting revenue generation and collection, in addition to other measures that will strengthen fiscal policy of counties and the ability to finance development plans. In a nutshell, a little bit of thinking outside the box is necessary and inevitable if we are to improve on the structure, the quality, and the content of devolved governance. But having said that, let me now add something on this animal called corruption, because all this development will not happen unless we tame that dragon called corruption. And I've said before that corruption exists virtually in all countries in the world. The difference is what is done when it is discovered. This is the only difference in regard to corruption. In places like in the United States and in Europe, when it is found, the action is taken immediately against those who are involved. I give you examples. Last month, Egypt's transport minister, Mr. Hisham Arafat, resigned after a train crash in Cairo killed at least 25 and left 50 injured. He was not the driver of the train, but he took responsibility and resigned. Last year, Mohamed Ibrahim resigned as governor of the central bank because of concern that money raised from the sale of land by government could not be fully accounted for. Nobody said he stole the money, but it was enough that the money was lost under his watch. He took responsibility. In August 2018, Indonesia's social affairs minister, Mr. Idris Marham, resigned after being named a suspect by the Corruption Eradication Commission. The minister said that his move to back down from his position was based on ethical and moral reasons. And four, in November last year, South Africa's Home Affairs Minister, Malusi Gigaba, submitted a resignation to President Cyril Ramaphosa after being accused of corruption. In the letter, Gigaba said, and I quote, "He has chosen to place the interests of the African National Congress, ANC, and the country above his personal interests." And he resigned. So he's taking responsibility. You will remember about 4 years ago or 5 years ago, a president from South Korea came to visit Kenya here, Madam Park. When she went back to Korea, she was accused of having given favor to one of her friends. And then she was eventually impeached by parliament. And having been impeached, she was arrested and charged and is right now serving a jail sentence of 25 years. one of the politicians I admired most in Brazil, the former President Lula, is right now in jail. And in fact, the court recently enhanced the sentence against Lula in Brazil. Last year, the Indonesians, the Malaysians, because they were sick and tired of the corruption under the former prime minister, voted Mr. Mahathir at 94 years of age to come back. And Mahathir immediately moved to action and arrested the former prime minister and his cohorts. And within 2 months, he had recovered $50 billion of money which has been lost. And that former prime minister is in jail as we are talking today. So, what about here in Kenya? You hear about these mega corruptions, and they're not fictions. They are facts, they are allegations. But then, when this happens, the matter is highly politicized. Instead of the politicians leaving the institutions charged with the responsibility to deal with them, politicians take it upon themselves to rush to funeral gatherings. Our community is being targeted. So being targeted, you're ruining the future of the children of our community, and so on and so forth. Why are we only targeting people here and there? If corruption is in a particular department, you arrest those who are there. You cannot go and invent other people to balance it, do a balancing act. That why have you arrested the Luos here? Why have we not seen a Kalenjin? Why have we not seen a Luhia or a Kikuyu here? No, the Luo who was there is the one who must be arrested, because he's the one who did the act. So this is something that must be dealt with. And the politicians must allow the institutions charged the responsibility to do their work. This is overdue, and it is important. It is important that we address this issue. We allow this institution to function properly. And here, we must also look at the issue of gender. We must ensure also that women folk are given responsibilities that they deserve in our society. We must recognize our women, because our women are capable of doing the right things. So we must give them the responsibilities, not that this is just a woman. No. She is a Kenyan like any other Kenyan. She must be given equal opportunity like any other Kenyan. So what we are seeing today is what is common in those who live in towns, in estates, where I lived as a child, where when a thief has stolen and anafukuzwa, mwizi huyo, sali mwizi nakimbia na anaona mtu mwingine ambaye mwoga, akiona kama mwizi nakuja, anaanza kukimbia. Mwizi nasema, mwizi huyo. He points at the other person. So those who did not know where this thing started chasing the other fellow who was running because he was fearing the thief who was being chased. Eventually he's caught and the poor guy is punished, basically because the thief has run scot-free. So if you are talking about the theft of the dams and figures are there, don't come and tell us that it was not 20 billion, it was only 7. Let the investigation authorities complete their investigations. Who are you to tell us? How did you know? You are the thief who is trying to show us that, oh, the thief running away. Give us a break. And as I said the other day, Kenyans must know, say enough is enough, and that nobody is above the law. And as the president said yesterday, if you have got evidence against him, take it. Bring me any evidence against the president, I will take it myself. If you fear to go to see me, So let us wait for the investigation to be complete. Let everybody else, and if the Indonesian can, the minister can resign. If the Koreans can imprison a sitting president, why should Kenyans not do anything? So let us agree that this thing will happen to everybody. If it is Raila Odinga, Raila should answer to himself. Everybody should be allowed to carry their own crosses without involving other people. This is what I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much. I wish you all the best.